Oh, Lord, Berta, Berta. Oh, Lord, God, Helena.
This is a story of America's bloodiest prison, told by the people who lived it, both inside and outside its gates. The brutal history, as you've never heard it before, from its origin as a slave plantation to its gradual growth as the bloodiest maximum security prison in America. To those outside its gates, it's known as Louisiana State Penitentiary at Angola. But to those who have spent time inside its gates, it's known as Bloody Angola.
Come with us as we take you through the gates and give you a firsthand look at not only the stories of the stabbings, rapes, executions, escapes, and murders you won't find on any TV show or the internet, but also the murders, abductions, attacks, and hostage situations of the staff and their families, otherwise known by the convicts as free people.
Bloody Angola is a comprehensive, no-holds-barred podcast that takes you on a journey through time from its inception as a slave plantation to America's largest maximum security prison, where 80% of its population will die inside the wire.
Get mentally prepared. Sit back and listen as we cover these stories in detail
in ways that you've never heard before from people that lived it, breathed it, and died with it. Bloody Angola. Warning, Bloody Angola is a podcast covering actual events and is intended for mature audiences.
The subject matter discussed in no way reflects the personal opinions of the host or sponsors of this podcast.
Thank you.
Hey, everyone, and welcome back to another edition of Bloody
Angola,
a podcast 142 years in the making.
The complete story of America's bloodiest prison.
And I'm Jim Chapman.
And I'm Woody Overton.
And today, y'all, we have a heck of an episode for you. Dr. Billy Cannon.
That's right, Dr. Billy Cannon. I actually have his helmet sign in, the 1959 Heisman Trophy winner for LSU. It's in my bar.
He is, for those of you that may not be listening to us from Louisiana, if you don't know who Billy Cannon is, you're crazy. Yeah. He is a hero here, deep, deep, deep into the folklore of South Louisiana, especially the Baton Rouge area, which we broadcast out of. And we were real excited to talk about him today because he has quite the history at Angola and quite the history before Angola.
That's right. And like we told you, each episode would be different. And Jim worked his magic on the research stuff and blew my mind with a lot of stuff that you found that I didn't even know. And I thought I was a Billy Cannon aficionado, right? But it ties back in to Bloody Angola and in the Louisiana history. It's pure love. The Instrument High School was a big deal, especially in sports.
100%. And, you know, when you meet what I would call back then old timers, right, when you would meet those folks and you say, where did you go to high school? They either went to Instrument or Baton Rouge High.
That's right. That's right. Absolutely. The truth. Yeah. So Billy Cannon went to Instrument High School in Baton Rouge, and he got noticed really quickly, y'all, for his athletic ability, his size and his speed and strength. And he was a three-sport star, but excelling in football, basketball, and track. Now, back then, they really didn't have many more sports than those, right?
Yeah,
maybe had
right.
Baseball. So he basically was the cock of the walk. He excelled at everything that he did. And of course, he lettered in all three sports.
100%. And the thing that made Billy Cannon so special, y'all, was his size and his speed were, in those days, almost unheard of. The guy ran 109.4 seconds, which is almost world class. That's like almost lightning. Olympic speed.
Lightning.
And he was 6'1", 210 pounds, right. Which back in those days, that didn't happen. That was big.
Yeah, I mean, and
to you were eating your Wheaties.
That's right. He was a strong corn-fed boy, you can believe that. And just quick as lightning. Imagine if he had had the studies and the things that they do for these athletes now when they train them for the combine and stuff like that. You know, the sprint stance and different things. He would have smoked that record even more.
He would have killed it. And look, good-looking guy, had a flat top. Yep. He was the prototypical-looking athlete, just had a very structured jawline. Great hair, flat top, yeah. And just looked mean.
Were the rage in the '50s, right? Yeah. My dad came up at the same time, and that's what they wore. But he had that smile and that size. It's just an all-American stud.
He really was, and you mentioned all-American, and he was one in high school. Eventually, in his senior year in 1955, he was named not only to the All-State team but the All-American football team.
That's crazy.
Scored 39 touchdowns as a senior, and he led Ostrom to the Louisiana State Championship.
And in track, he set the state record for the shot put at 56 feet, as well as a 100-yard dash at 9.6 seconds, which was also a state record. And like Jim said, he was 6'1", 210 pounds. Let me tell you something. I threw a shot put in high school. I ain't come anywhere near that.
56 feet, y'all.
That's a long ways, dude.
That's a long way.
What a stud, right?
Yeah, and it was also at that time that he kind of got in his first legal trouble. And Billy throughout his life and the journey we're going to take you through, it seemed like his upbringing, kind of a tough, you know, he grew up in kind of a tough neighborhood. He was poor, so he was forced to kind of maybe walk a tight line with the law, let's just say. And so this was his first legal trouble. He got a 90-day suspended jail sentence while he was still in high school. And get this, y'all, him and some high school friends basically extorted grown men who they would catch with prostitutes. So these guys would walk out of maybe a cheap motel, and Billy Cannon would be standing out there with three of his buddies, and he'd say, give us $50 and we're telling your wife.
Yeah, exactly right. I mean, you know, being an athlete like that and a young man is certainly being famous amongst your peers and throughout the state is breaking all these records. You kind of get to thinking you're a little bit untouchable, right?
That's right.
But still, he wasn't getting paid. And yeah. So what do? They push the limit and they catch Johns where they're in the cars with the prostitutes or whatever. Then they hung out. And when they came out, they shook them down.
What are these guys going to do? Yeah. I mean,
God knows how long they got away before they got arrested.
He moved on. He got a scholarship to LSU.
Yep. And at LSU, he would win the Heisman Trophy in 1959 and led LSU to the national championship. His legendary punt return against Ole Miss on Halloween night is still played at every tailgate practically. And South Louisiana boys can almost recite it play by play and word for word. And let me tell you this. My mom and daddy were there that night, and you're damn right I can recite it. It gives me goosebumps to this day. The other day when Halloween came, it was on a Monday, but that Saturday night, even though they played Ole Miss the week before, I thought about that play.
One of the most historic runs ever in the history of college football. But you'll notice when we play this clip how loud the crowd gets, and it gives me goosebumps because – the guy calling that play-by-play, there's a point you're going to hear where you can't even hear the guy. Yeah, the crowd is so loud.
Jet engines. Yeah. It's Death Valley, LSU Tiger Stadium. And Ole Miss back then certainly was their biggest rivalry. Go Ole Miss is what they used to say, even when I was a kid.
That's right. And still is to this day.
And if you get the chance to see the video, it'll be in black and white if y'all want to go look that up. But you got to hear this clip.
Ole Miss on 28. He gets a pass from center. He boots it and gets another nice kick away going way downfield. Billy Cannon watches it bounce. He takes it on his own 11. He comes back upfield at the 15, stumbles momentarily. He's at the 20, running hard at the 25, gets away from one man for 30. Still runs at 25, at the 35, at the 25. He's down to 50. He's in the 50, 45, 40. some 89 yards for a touchdown. Listen to the cheer.
So I hope y'all enjoyed that, and I hope y'all noticed how loud that crowd got. And we just love that here in South Louisiana.
And y'all, those of you who don't know, when he won the Heisman Trophy in 1959, that was the first LSU player to ever win the Heisman Trophy. And the only one to win it since was Joe Burrow.
You are the best player in the United States right. in college football. So Billy Cannon became an absolute hero overnight. That Halloween run, that is, you know, in a lot of people's opinion, what won him the Heisman Trophy. So he was already a hero. Right. And then you tack the Heisman Trophy on top of it, and he was bigger than life.
Yeah, just huge.
Bigger than life. And I can tell you from someone that met him, I met him at a very old age, and you know, for Billy Cannon, I went to an autograph signing, got him to sign a helmet, actually, and he was a lot older, but he had this aura about it that you know it was just Billy Cannon. It was really cool.
The Billy Cannon swag.
That's right.
Swagger.
Yeah. Swagger, yeah. Tons of swag. So Billy moved on. He went to the AFL and the NFL, and he played 11 seasons. Retired with the Kansas City Chiefs in 1970.
He'd use his off seasons to study dentistry, y'all, and he earned his DDS at the University of Tennessee. And later on, he got additional degrees in orthodontics, all while playing pro football. So that's unheard of, right?
Totally.
Even though they weren't making as much money back then. First of all, playing 11 years in the NFL, when the helmets and there were no concussion guidelines and stuff. You try to knock the snot out of people, right? That's what our coaches used to teach us. And so, but he played 11 years and studied and became a dentist and got an additional degree in orthodontics, all while being a pro football player.
Although Billy grew up kind of rough, and he skirted the law a little bit. He was smart. He was dummy. Very smart. Interesting little side note on that. He was married as a freshman in college to a beautiful lady named Dot. Yep. And they actually were married his entire life. So it was interesting to me that he got married at the age of 18. Stayed, never got a divorce.
Right.
And this woman put up with some stuff now with Billy over the years.
Right. 11 years in the pros and then everything else that came. But you know what? Love is love, right?
That's right.
I hardly ever hear people staying married that long anymore.
That's exactly right. So he does. He leaves pro football after 11 years, and he goes into dentistry full time.
Yep, and his dentistry practice was booming. And if I go on to the dentist, I'd love to go to Billy Cannon.
Yeah.
It'd be like having Joe Burrow be my dentist, right?
That's nowadays, exactly right.
That'd be cool as shit. I'd be like, hey, he put his hands in my mouth.
That's right.
But, hey, his practice was booming, man. And everybody was, you know, he had like a waiting list and for Dr. Billy Cannon to work on people's teeth. But he also started a successful real estate development firm at this time.
Yeah, so his life was going as great. You know, that's kind of how Billy's life was. It was almost a fairy tale. He was married to this beautiful woman. He had money coming in from his real estate development firm, and he was a dentist who had to turn patients away because he had so many.
11 years in the pros, and
only
Heisman Trophy winner for LSU, and he's still famous. Probably the most famous player besides Burrow to this day LSU ever had. But you know what? It goes back to that mindset. You know what? How many times cops might have stopped him for drinking and driving or speeding or whatever? Hey, fuck, that's Billy Cannon. I'm not doing anything to him, right? And you get that mindset. Maybe like when they were rolling Johns, trying to blackmail him back in the day, maybe you push that gray area.
Yeah, and I'm sure he did. Woody Everton, outside of true crime, what podcast is tops on your playlist right now?
Let me tell you, Jim, my favorite thing about Mondays right now is it means a new drop of dirt, grit, and stupid shit. Adventures in Real Estate with Sandra Richard.
Mine too. Sandra's hilarious look at everyday life of a real estate agent makes those Mondays tolerable.
So go right now to Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube, or wherever you listen and subscribe to Dirt, Grit, and Stupid Shit. And I promise you, you will love it.
dirt, grit, and stupid shit. Adventures in real estate, making Mondays fun days. Hey, y'all, if you have trouble of any sort with your vehicle, I recommend checking out Performance Tire and Automotive in Denham Springs, Louisiana.
Y'all, recently, on both of my trucks, I bought all new tires, had oil changes, windshield wipers, everything. I went and saw Ben at Performance Tire and Automotive, and he hooked me up.
Give him a call at 225-665-9885.
The best honest service you can ever find for your vehicle, Performance Tire and Automotive.
PerformanceTireAndAutomotive.com for more information.
Right there in Denham Springs, Louisiana.
Not only ladies have problems with their hormones being out of place. When I noticed my hormones felt out of line, I went to Flourish Hormone Replacement and Wellness Centers in Denham Springs.
Hey, I went and got my blood tested because my wife was going for to Flourish, and I didn't even know anything was wrong with me. And guess what? Everything was wrong. But Flourish took the personal time, and they got my health even better than it was, y'all.
Yeah, and they don't just do hormone replacement. They do all kinds of different massages. They have vitamin B shots and injections to really get your vitamin B up there where it should be.
Yeah, and it's, again, for me, it's the personal attention. I've had them call me after hours when the blood work came back, after the doctor, after Miranda was studying my stuff, and she really, really cares, and they really go out of the way to give you your best health options. The hormone replacement is just the tip of the iceberg.
So we both recommend Flourish Hormone Replacement and Wellness Centers in Denham Springs.
Not only do we recommend it, we use it, y'all. I stand behind them 1,000% as health professionals and as people.
That's right. Check them out for more information on their website at flourishhormonereplacement.com.
Or give them a call at 225-283-1211.
And Billy had kids during this time. One of his kids was aptly named after him, Billy Cannon Jr. And I want to highlight him because he was very important in Billy Cannon Sr.'s life and probably a better athlete than his dad. Billy Cannon Jr. actually played at Broadmoor High School in Baton Rouge and was 6'5", 225 pounds, and was almost as fast as his dad, if not as fast.
That's crazy. Yeah, and I mean, he was a stud.
Total stud.
Right, and he would go on to play football at Texas A&M after being the prep star and All-American from Broadmoor.
That's right. And interesting side note on that, my former high school football coach, Rusty Price, at Broadmoor High School, also coached Billy Cannon Jr. And I have a clip that we're going to play for you right now where Rusty Price is actually talking about Billy Cannon Jr. and what it was like to coach not only an athlete in his own right, but the son of Billy Cannon.
Talk about Billy Cannon Jr., your time there. I know the late Bob Carter was there with you. And
I was assistant coach under Bob, and Billy was there. This is in the late 70s. It was a unique opportunity to see somebody that could do it all. I'll tell you, if you go by athletic ability alone, you know, there's been a lot of great athletes that have gone through Baton Rouge and stuff, but I don't think there's been any that have had the impact that he could had in any sport.
You know, went to A&M and had a great career there, started off as a wide receiver.
I believe Billy played four different positions there. Wide receiver, defensive back, outside linebacker, then the inside linebacker. And if it wouldn't be for the injury, there's no telling where it would have taken him.
Yeah, the rookie season, first-round draft pick of the Dallas Cowboys, a 25th pick that year, and that rookie season going midway almost the season, that was the last of the football career.
So we wanted to paint kind of a picture for you of how good Billy Cannon's life was, how great it was going. It was just rocking. Everything was great. His son was at Texas A&M playing football. And then something happened to change everything.
Yeah, and this crazy twist to the story, right? I'm going to read you an article from Sports Illustrated in 1983. It says, according to Assistant U.S. Attorney Rand Miller, Cannon met with a neighbor, John Stiglitz, and a convicted counterfeiter in January of 1980 to discuss a counterfeiting scheme. 6 months later, Cannon gave Stiglitz $15,000 to buy a printing press to get started. The work on the bills, the plates were quite good, says Miller, but the quality of paper was poor. It was done in a warehouse in Cleburne, Texas on April's Fool Day, 1981. Stiglitz delivered approximately $1 million in counterfeit $100 bills to Cannon, who had then shipped them to William Glasscock in Pensacola, Florida. Glasscock, who planned to put the bills into circulation by selling them for a fraction of their face value, is being held on counterfeiting charges in lieu of $2.5 million bond. By September 1981, Stiglitz has sent another $5 million in bills to Cannon. Authorities began to unravel the scheme last year when several of the bogus bills showed up at Baton Rouge Shopping Center. An investigation eventually led the feds to suspect Cannon and others. On July 7th, an informant told authorities a big sale was being arranged by two of Cannon's accomplices, Timothy Melanson, and a general merchandise broker from Thibodaux, Louisiana, and Charles Whitfield, who says he has several businesses, including a hog farm in Florida and shrimp boats. Both men have been charged with conspiracy to possess and deal in phony money. Last Saturday, Melanson also was indicted for conspiring to import and distribute 340 pounds of marijuana. Further said, the informant Melanson has been in touch with Cannon, who had been under 24-hour surveillance for more than a month. At noon on July the 8th, Melanson picked up Cannon at Cannon's office and then drove in an erratic, evasive manner to a spot down an unmarked dead-end road off of Jones Creek Road on the outskirts of Baton Rouge. There, Cannon pointed out where he had buried some of the money. After returning Cannon to his office, Melanson picked up Whitfield, and the pair headed back to the Jones Creek Road lot. Their speed ranged from 30 to 80 miles an hour. They stopped by the side of the road, made some U-turns, went up dead ends, stopped off at three convenience stores, drove through residential sections. Never did they notice the eight-car tail of law enforcement officers following them.
If they saw it on James Bond, said Miller, they did it. Five times they drove past the road in the lot before taking a turn. After digging up approximately $2.2 million in counterfeit money, they drove to an office building parking lot. Melanson left and was soon arrested. Whitfield stayed, tossing the two plastic garbage bags with the loot into a dumpster. Whitfield waited for the purchaser, who was an undercover agent, to show up, which he did about 9 p.m. Whitfield thought he could sell about $2 million, but the buyer said he only wanted $1.2 million at 20 cents on the dollar, which equates to $240,000. The agent also said he didn't have the cash with him. Yeah. He departed, and supposedly to get the money, and shortly after, Whitfield was taken into custody. So later that night, approximately 10 Secret Service agents and others, including Miller, went to the snake-infested Jones Creek Road lot to dig for more money. They only had two shovels, and they dug for several hours. Finally, Secret Service agent Mike James called out, "I think we got something here." He dug down a foot and found two large red igloo coolers, now empty, but believed to have contained money Melanson and Whitfield had picked up. So about 10:30 a.m. on the next day, Cannon stopped by the lot to show it to a business associate. Four of the lawmen had remained on the property through the night. Cannon asked him, "What's going on?" And they had a search warrant and left. Cannon, who owned several thoroughbreds, then drove to Jefferson Downs Racetrack near New Orleans. In mid-afternoon, the day one of Cannon's daughters knocked on Buck Kleinpeter's door and said, "Some men from the Secret Service want to arrest my daddy," said Kleinpeter. "I knew the Secret Service deals with two things, protection of the president and counterfeiting, and I knew Billy hadn't been with the president." When he returned home at 4 p.m., Canham was arrested. He wanted to plead guilty right away, but Judge Frank Palazzola told him to think over the decision. Before I continue, that kind of tells you how popular Billy Canham was. You got the judge basically saying, you sure you want to do that?
They got streets named after Palazzola and Jefferson Parish, and he was the original hard ass. For him to say, think about it, that shows you how much stroke.
So Canham immediately cooperated with the government, showing officials where an additional $2 million was buried in two large coolers in the ground next to his office. He drew a map of the area of the Jones Creek Road property where another $750,000 or so in counterfeit money was buried. And later an agent returned and said, Billy, I'm a little embarrassed, but even with your map, we can't find the money. Canham laughed and said, if you can't find the money on a map, maybe I should withdraw my plea. The money was quickly found. The trouble with the map having been that Canham had omitted a crucial tree from the drawing. Miller said without Canham's assistant, the only way the buried counterfeit money would have ever been found would have been to plow up the entire city of Baton Rouge. So the reason we read you that is we told you how good Billy Canham's life was going. And in 1983, it all went to shit.
Yeah, but you know, that's... Again, that's really pushing the gray area because you don't just come up with millions and millions of dollars of print stuff. Like you said in the article, he had to seek out to buy the stuff. Then they got it printed. But look, shit, Jones Creek now is so populated that who knows where it was at. But to bury stuff long enough where you can go out there as an officer and look and you can't tell the ground is disturbed, this has been going on for a minute.
Yeah, I mean,
he didn't just start. And Lord knows how much they passed or sold to people for 20 cents on the dollar. Hell, $250,000 back in 1983 was like $2.3 million now.
No doubt about it.
And I'm sure they got away with it for a while. And even had it buried outside his dentist's office.
Yeah, sure did. And he basically gets charged, he gets arrested, he goes to court, and to Billy's credit, he never denied that he did it. He completely admitted to it, and he said he had some gambling debts and some bad investments that he had made in the real estate world, and eventually got charged with his involvement in a $6 million counterfeiting scheme. Interesting, y'all, that it's the seventh largest counterfeiting scheme in U.S. history.
That's crazy. And that's
freaking Billy Canham,
30
dude.
What, almost 40 years, right?
That's right. And as we told you, the way they found this money, he was burying it in the ground in coolers, and they actually found some of it in two closets at his dentist office. It was just packed in there. So long story short, he got convicted and sentenced to 5 years in prison at Federal Correction Center in Texas and a $10,000 fine, which he pled to lesser charges than what was originally charged, and got released after 2.5 years.
Nowadays that doesn't happen. A couple things on the federal law. Counterfeiting naturally is federal, and like Jim said, the Secret Service protect diplomats and presidential figures or people that are up for election. And the only other thing they do, counterfeit, right? But they don't play. And so now when you get sentenced, you only get 1 day of good time for every year that you do. So back then, obviously, they've changed it some. But getting out in 2.5 years is a pretty good deal for Billy Canham. But imagine going
pretty good deal and had to have something to do with him being Billy Canham.
Yeah, but you had, I'm sure it did. But you go from having everything, and you're the most successful, gambling debts and shit. And bad real estate, the bad real estate part is documented. He got into some bad deals and got strapped and he did what he did, but he owned up to it and he took his lick. So, y'all, Billy does his time, right? 2.5 years. Now he gets released, okay? And he was able to get his dentist license back, but his reputation had been tarnished so bad that he couldn't get any patients. That's kind of crazy, right? You have a waiting list, and now nobody wants you to come in. But he was so poor, in fact, that T.J. Moran, who owned Baton Rouge restaurant known as T.J. Ribs, he cut a deal with Canham where Canham gave Moran his Heisman Trophy for display in the restaurant for free lunch for as long as the restaurant was in existence. Now, let me tell you this.